surgery does have major benefits, especially for groups such as Jehovah's Witness or any patient concerned about contracting hepatitis or AIDS, which I guess means all of us. The pioneer of the surgery is Dr. Ron Lapin, who now heads the Institute of Bloodless Medicine and Surgery and joins us in the studio now. Welcome.
Thank you very much. Nice to be here.
Now, I guess most people look askance when you start talking about bloodless surgery. It's such an alien concept to most of us because our picture of a surgeon operating is to have lots of the blood in the theatre or blood products there.
That is rather unfortunate because this is what has been portrayed in movies and televisions and so forth and so on, because the first thing somebody screams is for blood as the first line of defense, not recognizing, and we haven't recognized the medicine for a long period of time, that blood is probably the most dangerous substance we use in medicine today. It probably kills more than any other drugs that we use. And it should not be used as the first line of defense, but rather the last.
But by saying that it kills more people, don't you mean just contaminated blood?
Not necessarily by contamination. There are two problems that are inherited to blood transfusion. One is the fact that it is infected. Its safety from an infection standpoint is highly questionable, depending on what country and what the admission level on the part of the blood banking industry is. But I think the problem that is the most complicated and will never be conquered is the fact that blood is an organ transplantation. By definition, when blood is an organ, because an organ is any system that performs a specific function. Giving patients a couple of units of blood from another individual essentially gets you married to a couple of people, genetically speaking, for the rest of your life. You know nothing about their backgrounds, and the rejection phenomenon does occur as it does with any other organ.
Isn't it? I mean, we've certainly been using blood for a long time. We have very healthy blood banks. If you have O negative or AB positive or any of those sort of things, surely those bloods are going to be compatible.
No, they're not. The problem is that we only match for A, B, and O and Rh positive and negative. But there are about 500 minor factors for which we do not type and cross, nor do we have the facilities. And even if we did have the facilities, we only would find out that we just can't match them.
It's extraordinary.
It is extraordinary. The fact that you drive on a one-way street going the wrong way at 150 miles an hour and don't kill anybody doesn't make it right.
But Dr. Lapin, surely you're not saying that all of the operations that have happened this century that have used blood are going to fail or are not going to be married up, or that there's a chance of some genetic disorder because of this interbreeding?
The problem is that we really don't know the extent of that. We've only become aware of the immunology aspect of blood in the last maybe 10 years. We now know, for example, that cancer patients who are transfused die quicker than those who are not. That's cancer of the colon, the lung, the breast. We also know that it is a tremendous immune suppressor, and as such, having all of these inherited problems should be used as the last line of defense. With some care and a little bit of understanding of all of the inherited problems, we can reduce by 50 or 60% very easily, without endangering any lives of patients, the quantity of blood that is given to patients today. Because I think the majority of the blood that is given to make the doctor feel better, not the patient. But it is the patient, ultimately, that pays the price, not the physician.
I would imagine with that sort of attitude, you run up against a fair amount of controversy from mainstream medicine.
Well, mainstream medicine doesn't bother me because the medical profession has been accused for many years of doing a lot of things, but elasticity has not been one of the accusations. I think things are changing rather drastically. We now have a law in the United States that you, at least in California, that you cannot transfuse a patient prior to informing him all of the possible complications. Going to change, things will change in medicine, is because the public will demand it. The public is terrified about AIDS, notwithstanding that hepatitis kills more people than AIDS does. And we just celebrated 2 days ago the AIDS Day, and there's 10 million people in the world that have AIDS. We're right on target for the turn of the century to have 100 million people.
Yes, but not all of those people contracted AIDS through blood transfusion.
No, about 5% did. While I cannot control what people do in their bedrooms, and that's their own private lives, I certainly can at least make a dent in it and make some changes. While there are no really good drugs to control this disease, a vaccine would not be around in my lifetime. And so the only way I can do it is just make a bit of a change, which is better than nothing.
But surely after the early mid-80s, when in fact blood wasn't being screened quite as vigilantly as it is now, now we check and we check and we check. And well, I'm assuming that we're checking. And so that those, that horrific incident where so many hemophiliacs contracted AIDS through blood transfusion won't happen now.
Well, I doubt that very much. 2 months ago, the blood banking industry in the United States, basically the Red Cross, has admitted publicly that they cannot guarantee the safety of the blood supply, closed all the regional centers, and are going to try to revamp them and try to make testing a bit more safe. Most blood banking industries never tell you that blood is safe. They say it's safer than ever, which to me is tantamount to be a little bit pregnant. It is a safe or it is not. And if the United States Red Cross admits it, then I think that other countries should do the same. Blood has never been safe and never will be safe in the future. Alternatives, and there are other necessities, such as patients who have hemophilia, people who are treated with chemotherapeutic agents, and so forth and so on. But the future of transfusion will lie primarily in synthetic blood products, such as artificial blood, which is a petroleum byproduct. I suppose you can get an unleaded variety if you so choose to. But it is not of a human product, will not give you any diseases. It does only one function that you require it to do, and that's to carry oxygen. We have no fluids that we can give today to patients that will carry oxygen. This is the only one. It is making its comeback. We've first started testing it some 11 years ago. It was removed from the market for some political and economic reason on the part of the Red Cross. It's not making its comeback because of the realization that blood is not safe.
And what's the name of that again?
Fluosol.
Fluosol.
Right, and it's a petroleum byproduct. Now, I see the future going in that direction, and genetic engineering into forming hemoglobin molecules in laboratories, where we no longer will have to depend on somebody's specific genetic code in order to affect certain things that we don't want to be affected. Now, this has been recognized around the world, and I'm very glad that Kalia Hospital over here has had the foresight and the gumption to stand up in the front and look at it and be the first hospital to do that. It's not only good for Jehovah's Witnesses. It is good for everybody who recognizes the fact that blood is dangerous. And I think that the problem with that is that patients most of the time have held their doctors in such high esteem that they were afraid to ask any questions. Now, they must be informed consumers because, after all, we are in a service profession and we have to adhere to what the patients require.
Mm. Well, I think that's happening more and more. But with Jehovah's Witness, they can't even give, say, part of their blood beforehand, can they? Because they don't take any transfusion.
That's absolutely correct, but they will accept the blood that is recirculated to them at the time of the operation. Now, the majority of my patients have been Jehovah's Witnesses. They have, looking at that 20 years ago, I didn't believe in all of the things that they said. But as it turns out to be, they were correct. Blood is a very dangerous substance, and to stay away from it is a good advice for everybody.
Now, you actually trained right through mainstream medicine. I mean, you did all of the usual medical training. When was it that you discovered that there was another strand, or perhaps a different tack should be taken?
Well, I was gently persuaded by some Jehovah's Witnesses to operate on some of their people. Initially, I was reluctant. But I've always carried a motto in my life that was said by Mark Twain. I've never allowed my schooling to interfere with my education. And so I am very glad that I've had the opportunity to work on these people because it has made me a better surgeon. And I can pretty much say that I'm one of the only surgeons in the world who has never seen a case of AIDS or hepatitis, and never will, because not my patients have ever gotten it after surgery because I don't use any blood.
Do you operate on people who have AIDS or hepatitis?
No, I do not. I don't have them. Jehovah's Witnesses are certainly the class of people against which all AIDS will have to be compared. They are not sexually promiscuous. They don't use intravenous drug and don't take any blood transfusions. How can they get AIDS?
But, I mean, you might have patients who aren't Jehovah's Witnesses coming to you.
Very few. I pretty much have dedicated my life to try to help a group of people who have been treated as second-class citizens in the eyes of the medical profession for years. I've done it as a civil rights issue at the beginning. I then became scientifically interested in it, and today I'm glad for it.
Dr. Lapin, perhaps we can go through some of the things that you actually do through your surgery.
All right.
You work on blood pressure and temperature, and I think you use more lasers.
Right. Well, let's take you through an operation. First of all, at the beginning of the operation, we dilute the patient's blood with about 5 liters, between 4 and 5 liters of saline solution, which makes the heart beat more efficiently, number one. But the best side effect of that technique is you dilute the number of red cells. Therefore, whatever blood you lose at the time of the operation is diluted. After that, we give patients medication in order to lower their blood pressure under control situations. Whenever feasible, we cool the patient down to accomplish the same thing, so the amount of blood that is lost is considerably reduced. Instead of cutting through sharp instruments, as most surgeons do, we use lasers or electrocautery because we cauterize our way through tissue, and cauterized tissue does not bleed. Whatever blood is lost is collected, filtered, washed, centrifuged, and returned back to the patient almost immediately, and we can do that within 3 or 4 minutes.
But wouldn't you still need to open somebody up to use the lasers?
Well, yeah, sure. You make a skin incision with a knife, but that's it. But the rest of the opening up, you do it with a laser. And you carry the whole procedure along those lines. And one thing else that we've incorporated in is extensive use of stapling devices instead of stitching, primarily for the protection of ourselves. First of all, these devices work much better than stitching by hand. But on the other hand, I think that the next at risk and high risk to receive AIDS are surgeons. We get stuck rather frequently doing operative procedures, perhaps as much a week, and all it takes is one stick. And I think that surgeons should be very cognizant and try to stay away from as much as injuring themselves and try to stay away from blood products.
Yes. Dr. Lapin, what has been the response so far to your bloodless medicine?
Well, certainly it's been marvelous in Kalia Hospital, certainly here. I've had quite a warm reception as well in New Zealand and around the world. This is the fifth continent that I've visited, probably be the last. And I'm very glad to see that in Australia there's a hospital like this that, small as it may be, it's got its scientific data placed in the right place, willing to put their money where their mouth is, and hopefully offer a service to everybody, not just Jehovah's Witnesses, which has a very small fraction of the population.
Dr. Lapin, it's been very interesting to talk with you. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure, and thank you for your time.